right. Hello, everyone. It's just after five, so we might as well kick off because I am the last speaker between you and drinks. So I'll try to keep it brief. So my name's Vanessa Little. I'm the global CTO over at a company called InterDynamic Systems, which is owned by a larger company called Converge. And long story short, we're system integrators. And we operate globally, and we have a pretty robust retail practice, telecoms practice, and enterprise practice. So if you ever see our name around, that's what we do. So for those of you who know me, you know I've been in the industry for a while. I won't say how long, because it's too long. But I've spent a lot of time talking about orchestration and automation, specifically for telecoms. It's a topic I'm really passionate about, and it's something that I've spent a lot of time working on. So today I'm going to talk about what happened to telecom automation, and specifically, how do we get it wrong, and what are we going to do about it? So this is going to be a bit of a cathartic exercise for me to vent about all of the things that we've kind of missed the mark on, but also to talk a little bit about how we can do it better going forward and from those lessons learned. So what was the promise of NFV and orchestration and automation? We were kind of promised the moon and then some, that we were going to be able to save so much money on operational costs, we could automate all of our deployments, we could go to market a lot sooner, we could start automating our day two lifecycle management, we could patch things, expand the network, and upgrade things in the blink of an eye, and it was going to be fantastic, it was going to be amazing, it was going to be beautiful, it was going to change the world. There was a lot of money invested into investigating how this was going to work, what we were going to do, because the NFV market was projected to have a $122 billion growth by 2027. And I think that's an old stat. It's actually much higher than that now. And that number continues to grow with the rise of 5G and IoT and the fact that everything is going to be connected now. There's still a huge market for that and a lot of people really looking at it. And I think the biggest question everyone asked at first was, why would we even bother with orchestration? You know, we have a telecom network, now we're gonna virtualize it and we need to deploy it. Why can't we just use our existing operational procedures to do that? And the answer was that the network complexity just got infinitely more complicated. Now you have different types of hardware, you have commodity hardware as opposed to purpose-made appliances. You have this hypervisor layer. Now you have different ways of doing monitoring telemetry because you can't monitor single devices anymore as single points of failure. You have to monitor on the service level because now that you have this hypervisor layer, this software-defined network, sometimes software-defined storage, it's very difficult to pinpoint where the failures are because now you have to monitor an end-to-end service as opposed to a bunch of disparate little tiny pieces of infrastructure. And the big promise was everybody's going to be able to roll out new network services faster. You know, the old paradigm that it takes at least 6 months for a telecom to roll out a new service, and that was on a good day. That was if they really had their ducks in a row and nothing really went sideways. The promise was now you can do it in 2 weeks, and you could prototype it in a lab in a couple days, and everything's going to be great. So this was really what was driving moving forward with the orchestration market. And because of this, a lot of people did a lot of work. The standards bodies were all over it right away. So ETSI spun up a number of different communities. There was ETSI NFV, then there was NFV Test and the NFV Security, and the open source Mano project sprung up out of that. And there was so many people doing so much work and so much investment in defining what those orchestration standards needed to be. What are those northbound APIs need to be? What are the communications between the VNF and the element manager need to be? And this was all very clearly defined. And then these open source projects kind of sprung up from them. And we saw open source Mano, we saw ONAP come up. Now we're seeing things like Nefio continuing to spring up. And we also had all these commercial vendors come up to the table. And they had their own automation and orchestration solutions for NFV with a very specific methodologies and requirements. Vendors stepped up and virtualized all of their formerly hardware appliances, and they said, here's a virtual machine for our hardware appliances. Later on, this started evolving into containerized network functions. And the service providers jumped on it and really drove hard just because they were so excited about this new open ecosystem. And the fact that now that we have this automation engine, we can pick and choose from all these different vendors. We're not locked into a full stack vendor anymore. We can automate how we do this, and so we can go that much faster. So you saw open source communities springing up. You saw NFV communities springing up inside of each of these different vendors. They put a lot of staff on the problem, and they put a lot of people redesigning their network architectures, redesigning their operational procedures, and really looking at what it actually meant to them to start virtualizing their network functions. But then we kind of did it wrong. The standards bodies moved at the speed of standards bodies. They didn't do anything wrong, but they couldn't publish them fast enough. These were complicated standards that needed a lot of people to work on them. And what happened was they were being released at the same time as people were trying to code against the spec. So you're trying to develop software against this moving target. And it was you know, nearly impossible. And it's still very much a work in progress. The standards are always being ratified, but 6 or 7 years ago, they were springing up from nothing. And so being able to code against a spec that was published like a week ago was next to impossible. The roles and responsibilities about who was responsible for what was really unclear early days in the standards bodies, and that's why we ended up seeing a bunch of different communities. 3GPP ran with some stuff, Etsy NFV ran with some stuff. There was some overlap, there was a little bit of conflict there early on that I think is not so much the problem today, but early on it created a lot of confusion. The open source communities were so excited about it, they did 100 different things, ran in 100 different directions, and nobody really did it together. So you had ONAP and OSM spring up at almost the same time, like it was just a matter of months apart. And they went in completely different directions. There was no collaboration there. They almost became competitive communities. So you had all these like-minded people that really wanted to build an open source orchestrator and wanted to realize the vision of that and champion it. But we kind of split the resource pool into two separate projects that competed with each other, and it made zero sense. We ended up with the modeling language wars, the Tosca versus Yang, and still we see things like that. You know, you can do it in now with the containerized functions. You still got Terraform, you have Helm charts. There's no consistency. There's no one de facto industry standard to say this is how you model a network function for a telecom. It's still very much something you can pick and choose. It's usually a hybrid of a number of different things that you have to smash together. You need a development team to be able to do that, and it's inconsistent, so that I couldn't write one for my telecom and loan it to another person. They'd still have to almost refactor it from the ground up to make it useful to them. And there's a sync lack of collaboration. There's a lot of talk about maybe OSM and ONAP are going to get together and start collaborating. We had a few meetings. Never happened. And it really became religious between those two factions. And that's the way I describe them, is they really divided into factions. Where you either champion one or the other. Like you would never say, I like them both. A telecom would put a stake in the ground and say, I choose this one, or I choose that one. Communities that were contributing to those code bases, they'd choose one or the other, but never both. So you there were only a few vendors that actually actively participated in both of those communities, and those are the massive companies like Intel, for example. They had, and Nokia had, people that were in both. But for the most part, you had to call it early, just pick one or the other and sort of bet on that horse and hope that it worked out. And because we did that, neither of them really did yet. The commercial vendors came up and said, okay, well, y'all want orchestration? We'll build your orchestration. But what they built was proprietary systems that only worked with their own VNFs. And while they said, yes, we've coded against the Etsy specs and we adhere to the Etsy interface specs, they kind of did, they kind of didn't. And because the VNFs didn't implement those specs 100%, and sometimes some of the specs were a little bit nebulous, so they could go, there was a little bit of leeway there. Those interface points weren't exactly as rock solid as everyone expected them to be. And so those commercial solutions only worked with their VNFs and CNFs. If you wanted any kind of openness to your network, you couldn't use their orchestrator. You were locked into their stack, and that was all you could really do. Another thing they really glossed over was they really only looked at the day zero deployment. And when you're looking at especially network functions like a mobile core, you don't redeploy it every day. You deploy it once, you scale it, you maintain it, but why would you pay for a very expensive commercial orchestrator, spend all that time to do the integration work and write all of your deployment scripts and your blueprints, and deploy it one time? What is the point of that? It's a massive waste of money. But that was really the mentality of a lot of these commercial vendors, is that you want orchestration, okay, well, you can automate your initial deployment, but they did nothing to service the day two lifecycle operations, and they tried to push all that responsibility onto these really proprietary element management systems, which nobody ever really wanted, but we were all kind of stuck with. And even today, we're trying to get these out of their network. Right before I came out here, there was a lecture by Sana, who is running she's vice chair of Nefio, and she was talking about the fact that element managers are a pain in the behind, and they're trying to get them out of their network, and they're trying to use proper cloud functions in order to maintain those VNFs and CNFs, as opposed to these proprietary black box VMs that do God knows what. And the commercial solutions were very expensive to integrate, especially if you wanted to try to bring on a third party's VNF. So if you had one commercial solution, but you wanted to, say you want to replace their IMS with somebody else's, that was a very complex integration effort that you had to pay them a whole lot of professional services dollars to get it to work. And that would be a bespoke one-off implementation that only worked for your company, and that code was not reusable. And if you wanted to do anything different with it, you had to pay them to do something else. So the VNF and CNF vendors, they were, in my opinion, one of the biggest issues in this whole paradigm, because they said, okay, we virtualized our network functions. But what they did was they took the code that was running in their physical custom-built appliance and stuck it in a VM and called it done. So now in order to get all of the performance you wanted, all the performance you used to get as that physical appliance, you had to do really unnatural things to the platform. You had to do like CPU pinning and so that you could get some NUMA alignment. You had to do SRIOV or PCI pass-through, and you had to violate pretty much all the core tenets of being in a cloud. So now you're paying for a hypervisor that you're not using, because you can't use it, you can't migrate these workloads because you've stuck them to a piece of physical hardware. So why'd you virtualize in the first place? You just spent a lot of money, time, and effort on integration for nothing. And finally, the telecoms, I think there was a certain expectation at first that they could continue to use their existing operational models, policies, and procedures to maintain this bit of infrastructure that was now night and day different from what they had before. And the way things were maintained, the way things were upgraded, the way things were scaled out were now totally different, because those adhered to cloud methodologies, which were totally new to telecoms at the time. I think telecoms have made a ton of progress there. I think that a lot of those early missteps were very quickly corrected. But there was still a fair bit of stumbling in the early days, and I think it really held back a lot of the rollouts, that the industry had this perception were going to happen a lot faster and a lot sooner and be a lot easier. So what was the net result of all of this back and forth? What we ended up with was this kind of a standoff between the service providers, the orchestration vendors, be they open source or commercial, the network function vendors, and the standards bodies. And they all kind of blamed each other for the ones to be responsible to fix this problem. So the standards bodies were saying, well, you guys have to code to our spec, and you have to do it very precisely, and you can't miss any part of it, except we're still writing the spec, but you got to code to it. The orchestration vendors were saying, here's how you orchestrate a network. And the orchestration vendors kind of split into two. There were the ones that came from the cloud side of the house and said, okay, here's how you orchestrate and automate cloud workloads. And then there was the ones that came from the telecom side of the house, and they said, here's how you orchestrate and automate telecom workloads. These two things are very different. And so we had these orchestration solutions that were very polarized. And some of them would do things like really go deep into the configuration of a VNF. And then you had some that would only deploy the VM and maintain it like a VM and try to scale it horizontally as if it was like a web server. But telecom workloads don't function like that. Most of them are extremely stateful. And treating them like cloud native services didn't work. So we had these orchestration solutions that academically and on paper did what they were supposed to do, but the implementation of them and in practice, they didn't actually do anything useful. And then people started to question, did we even need orchestration? And what ended up happening was people continued to move forward rolling out their network functions virtually. They built out their virtualized networks and all these things went into production, especially for 4G and LTE networks. And now we're really seeing it in the 5G network rollouts. There are no physical appliances there anymore, but they're not orchestrating or automating anything because orchestrators never worked, not like they were supposed to. And as we went through this whole exercise, there was one thing that everybody seemed to forget. There was one thing that we were all blind to in the whole community, in the whole industry, in the whole world, and that's we're not talking about a telecom network anymore. We're talking about a telecom cloud. And a telecom cloud is not the same as an enterprise cloud, and it's not the same thing as a traditional telecom network that was built on appliances. This is a new thing. This is a new entity that had never existed before. But we kept trying to smash that square peg into one of the other two round holes. We were, for the most part, trying to smash it into an enterprise cloud hole. And the software wasn't ready. The software is still not ready. The VNF vendors and the ones that are making CNFs now, in my opinion, are still wholeheartedly missing the mark. They're not making completely stateless applications. So if you want to maintain it like an enterprise cloud, then the apps need to catch up. If you want to use the apps that are in market today, then you can't think about it as an enterprise cloud. And so that's why projects like Nefio that are springing up, they recognize this. They recognize that this is a different entity. Telecom cloud is different. The applications are maintained in a different way than you would traditional enterprise applications. So what do we do? I mean, I think I've painted a pretty dire picture and, I've pretty much just stood up here and complained for the last 20 minutes. But what do we do about it? Well, the truth is, these are all lessons learned. This was a brand new industry, less than 10 years ago. I think we've made a lot of progress, and there was bound to be a certain level of missteps along the way. There was no way that we were going to get it right the first time. In the history of all telecom, I don't think that's ever happened, where we just came out of the gate and totally nailed it on our first attempt. This is even more prevalent because it is such a massive shift. Like when we made the transition from 3G to 4G, not that big a shift in the technologies. It wasn't that cumbersome. There was a few boo-boos that were very easily corrected. But when we're making the transition from traditional networks into NFV, we're changing pretty much everything in the stack. We're changing how we operate it. We're changing how we manage it. We're changing how we monitor it. We're changing how we scale it. We changed all of it. So the fact that we got as far as we have so far is actually a very positive thing. And my advice to the whole community is just keep at it. We've learned from our mistakes. The things that are happening now in projects like Nefio are very positive. They're addressing a lot of those challenges that were huge stumbling blocks and roadblocks previously. So what I can say to everybody is take a deep breath. It's going to be okay. We're going to get through this. Honestly, there are still so many people dedicated to working on these problems and to building solutions that are going to be viable, that are going to be useful to the community. They're going to be useful in production to real-life telecoms with real-life workloads on them that have real-life requirements and resiliency demands. We're getting there. I don't think anyone really thought it was going to happen overnight. I think we thought it was going to happen a little sooner than it had, but we're going to get there. We're moving in the right direction. We're not moving backwards. We're definitely moving forwards. And so long as we keep at it and we continue to reevaluate what we've done in the past and make sure that we're still learning from our mistakes and not repeating them, I think we're going to be good. So that said, this is one of my favorite topics ever to discuss. If any of you ever want to call me or, you know, debate, disagree, feel free. I love to discuss it. If any of you have any thoughts or comments or ideas that you want to discuss later on, feel free to reach out or just add me to LinkedIn because I love making new friends. But for now, does anybody have any questions or comments or thoughts? Ashok?
Thank you for the presentation.
Go ahead.
No, please. Maybe you want your end first.
You talk about standards not working. So, if you look into the history, the standards were created, standard bodies were created to keep pace with the technology. So technology was growing at a glacial speed, and so did the standards bodies. Things worked fine.
Yep.
Now this technology started moving very fast.
Yeah.
But the bodies have not, kept with it. So, take a project like Nephew. What would be a role of a standard body in a project like Nephew? How would it work? Should it work? I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, you make an excellent point because previously, before NFV became a thing, the standards bodies moved at the speed of telecom, which was like a snail. It was very slow. But when NFV came, the innovation in technology just went exponentially. It was changing every day. For a project like Nephew, I think the role of standards bodies, if the standards are already solidified and ratified and very close to finish, they're always going to be changes. There are always going to be updates because, technology evolves. But if those changes are things less than 10% as opposed to 50-60% as they were previously, I think they still have a very relevant role in projects like Nephew and in influencing them. Because standards, I still think standards are very, very important. Not just in the orchestration side, but in the entire community. Because how do VNFs know how to code against a spec? How does an orchestrator know what to do without the standards? There needs to be a certain level of governance and guidance there that pushes the community in a certain direction. Otherwise, you're just going to end up with a bunch of disparate islands of proprietary solutions again.
The nature of the governance bodies or standard bodies, they have to change to something totally different. The methodology of working. So you're right, we definitely need that.
Yeah.
But the nature of that has to change now, the new world.
Yeah, and I think we're starting to see that a little bit, especially in Etsy. And what they did is first they had the NFV standards body, and it covered all things NFV. It was completely comprehensive. And then a few years later, they said, okay, well, this is too big. It's too much. And we can't wait to release a different version to have all of these different things inside of it. So they started to split it. And now they have these little micro communities inside there that are laser focused on really specific things. So they're able to move a lot quicker because they're not approaching it holistically anymore. You've got just NFV test and NFV security, and they have a very small mandate that they have to maintain. So I think we've seen this. They're starting to pick up their speed. They're not going exponentially like the technology is, but they're night and day better than they were 5 years ago.
Few comments there. I completely agree, align with the parts that were identified. There was the one related to the VNF manager vendors, which for me didn't make sense from the beginning. Basically, it was us, it was Ericsson, it was Huawei, and if I remember it well, ZTE. We were the four of us, we were developing the VNF managers. And basically, in terms of the latency that was brought up, I'd say bringing up the network function, it didn't make any sense. That's the reason why we have evolved, and we now agree in terms of the industry that the way to do it, at least, it's really to regarding the CNFs, or at least which would really, I'd say, enable the capability to scale out really fast a service in case resources are required. Back on the standards, I don't think it would change so much. We continue to contribute. I also work with 3GPP, for instance, and we are working for 5G Advanced, for instance, for Release 18. And we need the standards. Why? Because it somehow guarantees the interoperability among different vendors. And that's the place, it could be someplace else, but that's the place we discuss, we argue.
Yeah.
At least with the major players in the market. Then, with Etsy, I agree completely with you, that's a can of worms now regarding Etsy and FBE, and the main reason it's it was brought, for instance, the containerization now, but it's kind of on top, it was not cloud native, now we are bringing it cloud native. But Etsy's ESM is another, I'll say, industry from Etsy, which is somehow the one that we are following. Though there are a few things related to the way the architecture, the logical architecture was built, which demands that we have an administrative domain for each technology, which this needs also to evolve. So I believe you have identified well the points. I don't think that those were, I'd say, necessary problems. I do think that it was a start. I agree completely with you when you say, I believe, the telco, the evolution from telco network to telco cloud, absolutely aligned. And it's missing the part that the telco providers or the telco vendors were sitting in a comfortable seat. I was speaking about that just a while ago. So for 6G, for instance, there is already this approach, or we are trying to do that in some research projects. I don't know if you are aware of XX. That's the one I'm working also. And there is a few things that we are conceiving there regarding orchestration continuum or the extreme edge, which where we have the extreme edge basically have the capability to work on their own. This was not thought before in the whole ecosystem. So, okay, to make it short and I'll finish, it's good, the points that you are in the fight, it's real. I don't think, in some cases, it's about destroying them, it's about an evolution. And Nephew and the standards, just to answer, are two completely different things. Okay, we agree with Nephew, we are working with them. Basically, it's trying to find with the IT players or the hyperscalers an architecture in terms of technology itself and a reference model for the network function. This standard organization do not work specifically.
Yeah, and that's a really good point you bring up is the standards organizations didn't address the fact that they didn't make it part of the spec that VNFs and CNFs had to be cloud native. It just sort of assumed that they would be. And that was a very false assumption. And I think that really caught us because the folks that started to write those standards understood what cloud native meant and they understood what it meant to live in a cloud. And they just made the assumption that everybody else knew that too. And they didn't explicitly bake it into the spec to say this is what cloud native means. Like this is, you know, these are the different features that you need to have to truly be cloud native. And I think almost everybody in this room has written a paper on this. Like we all really understand and have addressed this issue, but the standards bodies never baked it in. So now you see projects like Nephio that are saying this is what cloud native means. Like thou shalt code to this spec. And I think they're taking a good approach to it to kind of bridge that gap in the standards community.
They haven't talked to anybody else, either. So they kind of did it on their own. You know, I know Anakin has been addressing it, trying from the underside, right, from the infrastructure side. But we can't dictate it from the top down. You know, we can't dictate what the VNF, you know, the workloads look like. We can only say this is what we can support.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, this is where the standoff kind of perpetuates right now, because you see the VNF and CNF vendors, they're gonna code what they think the customer wants, but they're gonna do the bare minimum. They're gonna, you know, asking a VNF and CNF vendor to completely tear down their code base and start over and make it truly cloud native is almost absurd. I mean, those companies would go bankrupt if they tried. I think the industry was really hoping for a few disruptors to pop up, people that were like totally greenfield from nowhere that were writing truly cloud native network functions from the ground up. But it's not really that easy, especially if you're trying to follow the 3GPP specs that had nothing to do with being cloud native. Yes.
I mean, I've been working with all the networking vendors, you know, the routing vendors and the firewall vendors. None of them are willing to put in the effort.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's almost like the telecoms have to declare mutiny on them and say, we're not going to buy your stuff unless you guys code it this way. And it's difficult. What are you guys going to do? Just stop, turn off your networks? Like, you can't. Yeah, you still need to continue to do business.
Different things.
Because the network functions for the sake of rewriting.
I know. There's no point.
Nicer, there's no point. If there's some value in adopting a cloud native approaches for network functions, and the vendors will be motivated themselves to do it.
They haven't been so
about,
far.
The discussion is about conforming to some elusive model of cloud nativeness. It's pointless because it brings no value.
Yeah, you need to show them money.
The value, so where it value for you know, me as a telco is I can deploy something at the edge, and we're not talking about edge as a data center. You know, forget that. You know, the real edge. And if it has a smaller footprint, I can put more stuff out there.
Yeah. Yeah, Daniel, you were trying to say something?
No, I was saying there's the incentive is. Maybe you're right, maybe we won't stop buying because we need it. But I think it's a critical mass of demand. If the VNF vendors want to deploy on a hyperscaler, they will have to do cloud native because I want to be on the floor. And once they've done that, we can reap the benefits of that platform now being more cloud native, and now we can run it on our network properly. But now we're all busy.
They don't do it on the hyperscaler.
Well, they will. Because at some point, if they don't want to lose market share.
We're doing VMs. We're just doing VMs.
Well, for now. But, you know, it takes a couple. I mean, 2 years ago, nobody was on hyperscalers. Now hyperscalers all of VMs.
Yeah, and the hyperscalers are making significant investment there.
Azure bought Affirm. If Cisco, Ericsson, and Nokia don't want to lose market share to Affirm, they have to put the hyperscaler to compete with them. It's the natural evolution of the market that the big players will drive the industry, and then the industry will make some sort of a standard. We agree or not, it's not a point, but it will be more cloud because of the big players than the telco. Unfortunately, the telco are not driving it, and we're not, because we're buying from them.
Yeah.
The hyperscalers don't care. Once it's migrated, it will depend.
That's why communities like this are so important.
But
it's
I
like you can all get together and strategize on that.
We are working with hyperscalers already, and repeating that we focus on VNFs at this point in time, it's not real.
We
are not focusing anymore on VNFs.
But they're like so focused on different things than we are.
Yeah.
Yeah, true, but the point here is that standards are required to guarantee interoperability among different vendors. So that's where we'll find the major players where we can argue, we agree or not, where we see service providers. And nowadays, we see even hyperscalers there, like Alibaba or like Microsoft, which was not expected before at all. So, and the other thing is NEFIO initiative, which we think it's a good one, because it tries really to define, in terms of technology and also a reference model for the network functions. So it's moving slowly.
Yeah, I think it's gaining a lot of momentum. Yep.
I'm going to is there time for something else? I want to zero in on something else. First of all, I agree. This is very refreshing. Thank you. I agree with pretty much everything. I can add a few more slides to the Buckman problem. But I want to focus on something to do with open source, you know, on Red Hat and open source. Open source is pretty new for the top of the world. And also, open, going back to the standards body thing, I'll try to make this as brief as possible. But yes, standards work slowly. Source code works faster. So it's really, you know, when you build things, they will come. If you write things down, they'll never come.
But you need both. That's true.
And I'll say there are different kinds of standards bodies too. O-RAN is not Etsy. Oasis, where Tosca 2.0 is being developed, I'm one of the people working on it. Oasis is an open standards body. It works very differently from Etsy, right? And we have liaisons between all these different communities as well. But at the end of the day, you also need to actually build something that actually works. And then you get into the meritocracy of open source. Something works, something doesn't. But I want to underscore one specific thing where I think went wrong and is still going wrong, and that's open community. Because open source is one thing, but at some point we're going to do a post-mortem of what went wrong with ONAP, I hope. I'm sorry, I know there's still people involved, and I was involved for many years as well in ONAP and OpenO before that. And but I think we can already say that some things ONAP did not achieve everything that we wanted it to achieve, and it's not used in everywhere that. You know, the Polish announcements that
came only about half the code, that's why it didn't work. That's why it
half the code, and we already have about 500,000 lines of code, so we can talk about that as well. But part of the issue is, who are the participants in these open source communities? How much involvement do they have there? How well is Linux Foundation doing the job of shepherding and curating these communities as well? It's new to, you know, in the ONAP project, I worked with engineers. It was the first time ever working in open source, first time ever working with somebody who was not in their own company. And it was very refreshing and amazing for all of them, and it's still going on. But this is just like the second generation of it. It's still very new, it's still very awkward, and it needs to be better. So it's not just open source. Giving a donation, here's a gift to the Linux Foundation, here's 500,000 lines of source code, have fun. No. You need to build actually a community that's invested in it in the long term, in the short term, and wanting to make it well. We're still not quite there yet. But as you said, it's a good thing that we're here talking. It's a good thing that we're listening to your talk. And I think there is potential to do things better. But it's commitment to that. It's
yeah.
Not just open source.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And I mean, I always keep saying the telecoms need more skin in the game. The telecoms need to be the ones driving the industry, because you're the ones forking out the money for all this software. You know, you should be actually getting what you want. But not every telecom can be AT&T. And hire this army of developers to join these open source communities and contribute significant bits of code. A better strategy needs to be defined for those tier two and tier three operators that want to drive the industry, have very specific opinions about what they need for their business, but they don't have the budgets to throw at projects like this. There needs to be a vehicle for those people to contribute in a significant way to actually drive the industry forward without them, you know, breaking the bank on their business. And I don't know what that looks like yet. I think it's, you know, it's very much a work in progress, but.
It's kind of like you said, you know, the telco cloud is not the usual cloud. I think telco open source and telco community will also look different than communities in other places. So a lot of our models until now, from doing things like building the Linux kernel to building Kubernetes in the CNCF, maybe telco needs a different way of working together and building source code. Maybe it's a combination of standards and source code, different kinds of contribution agreements. We need to work it out together.
Yeah.
And it's missing one domain that is becoming really important. And this will push telcos, especially, to a new dimension, which is the satellite access and the satellite backhaul.
Yeah.
And this is going to change the game.
I think we're talking too much technology. I think we have to think much more business and power and who is really in charge. Because, I mean, we have unrealistic expectations. And if you have worked in standards and you've worked in open source, you can sort of sense what is possible and what's not possible. And that's not technology. Technology is not the one that sort of is the limiter. So, and you have to think about an organization that we think that if we really tell people technically and educate them and they will understand it, they will do it. They do understand it, but they don't like it. So if you automate something, you have to think, okay, who's winning, who's losing on that, who's in power?
Yep.
And if you run a network day from day, and somebody tell you, you should do something completely different, you have to turn it upside down. You don't want that.
Who's going to pay for it?
Yeah, who's going to pay? Who gets the blame if sort of subscribers are complaining?
Yeah.
Not the wise guys. It's the operator, the one. They have to be extremely conservative.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they will fail in their job.
Yeah.
We all have different roles. And I also think that many of the people that started the open source initiatives and pushed for the standardization, they had no experience. They didn't know what it is. And if you look at the O&M standardization, you will find that it used to be nothing. It was like FCAPs, it was reports and nothing more.
Yeah.
So we've come a very, very long term. So you can say that standardization is not moving fast enough. It's moving very fast in this area.
Yeah.
Compared to what it used to be.
Yeah, and in like telecom is a very risk averse industry, right? These are people's lives on the line when you're talking about emergency services. Telecom is an essential service, so open source is a very bleeding edge, cutting edge technology. It's a lot more risky. Like when you compare the two, open source communities look like total cowboy wild west, whereas telecoms look like, you know, the slow and steady little tugboat that's booting down the river. The intersection of those two, I don't think we've realized it yet. And to your point, defining what open source for telecom means is, you know, still very much a work in progress, because I think we just tried to apply the open source model to telecom and it went, didn't work. There's so many gaps, and it's like, you know, we keep continuing to butt heads and say, well, I want this, but I can only give you this, and I don't have enough budget for this, and I don't have enough budget to recode my apps from scratch. And I think there was this expectation that pushing everything to the open source community was going to magically fix all this stuff.
ONAP is the perfect example.
Yeah. Oh, ONAP wanted to be everything to everyone.
But I will give you a perfect example of fast standard environment. For instance, we don't speak about open source in terms of satellite access or support to non-terrestrial networks. Maybe there is a few things, there are a few exceptions for sure, but not something big. On standards, for instance, there is a lot of work already there.
But again, on satellite connectivity, people are doing things, and companies are doing things, and launching services and not waiting for standards to mature and while this is happening, you know, we're still debating here if ONAP and OSM is still addressing the need.
We are not debating the ONAP and the OSM.
I think we've given up. that ship is sunk, folks.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I don't want to compare the initiative of Nephew with the other. It is different.
I agree with that. Yeah. Nephew is not just another orchestrator.
Nephew doesn't exist.
Yeah. Nephew's code base is also teeny tiny. Yes.
It's a
does the first.
That's my nephew.
Well, it still has a long way to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're still writing code for the first
one. Yeah.
For tomorrow.
Yeah.
Yeah, but just one closing comment from my side. From all the problem statements, the way I see it, on the platform, there are a lot of guys talking, you know, redefining and coming with something new. And what is required really is on this application, right? And I don't think so that program like Nephew, like we will find a way to push the CNF or DNF, right? And, you know, I like the idea that we should not select and this, that, but this is a reality. Once you do a real project and that comes with a real SLA, really, yeah. You know, this is the gameplay of the CNF or BNF vendor, right? The way they, even they somehow dictate a way, which type of infrastructure, like even if it is Kubernetes, they dictate a way and they have a way, you know, I am sure there are some guys from those communities. So, what I see is the right way, right? Maybe it will take more, the way I see it. It's really about agree what we have. Let's say something in Enugreat, something with Nephew, and let's lock it and try to figure out now this application piece. Standardized benchmark, I don't know how you say it. And they should optimize it, obviously, right? Because that is missing. I don't know. But otherwise, I don't know, even Nephew, 2 years' time, we'll meet again and we will find another thing, I don't know, from someone, right? To
I'll be back up here complaining about them. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I think my only concern about Nephew is that they have extremely lofty goals. Like, they're trying to paint this picture of the utopian view of what it should look like, and there's still a massive gap between what Nephew is asking for and the way CNFs actually work.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I still don't see any vendors racing to rewrite their code, right? They're making small incremental changes that they can absorb into their budgets, and they're creeping toward that utopia, but the utopia is going to be something else by the time those applications get there. And only until those traditional network equipment vendors and software vendors start losing money, start losing market share, are they going to be driven to make any kind of real change? And I'm hoping that there's going to be some kind of really clever disruptor that just comes out of nowhere, some little startup that gets venture funded, that makes a mobile core that fits inside a container, it scales elegantly and beautifully. They're going to destroy this market. They're going to be so disruptive.
Not just the startup. If Apple decides tomorrow that they're going to have their own network, all telcos will be fighting for survival. Right?
Yeah.
The industry is fighting for survival.
But Google, somehow with the Nephew, they did the end over to Linux Foundation.
Yeah.
There's regulation.
If we look into it, if you look into the details, we see that Google saw that it was not possible to do such a thing without giving it to the community and hoping that some other partners participate. That is the reason why it's not with them anymore.
Yeah.
And it was given to the community.
And this was another big gap in the industry was these orchestrators built the orchestrators and they said, okay, here's our spec. Here's how you make a blueprint. Don't you want to make a blueprint? Will you please make a blueprint? And all the vendors said, no, I'm not spending engineering time on that because there's 5 different blueprint languages. Which one do I pick? And so we, like, how many workshops have we all been to where they had BNF onboarding seminars? Even I spun up my own open source community to try to address it. Everyone said that was somebody else's problem. And a lot of that stems out of the fact that there isn't one common language for modeling yet. I think that's a standard that we're missing. So if you build that, I think a lot of stuff is going to start to solidify. But get her done. How many years have you guys been on that? Like, come on.
They grow exponentially.
Yep.
The way ours work, sadly, is that if you change it, one interface, that's a new blueprint, right? But what we've seen, we built a white box with the ability to put VNFs and potentially CNFs on the box. The vendors made an end run around us because they saw they were losing control, and they went around and they started building their own stuff.
Yep.
So all the orchestrators, you know, we were trying to build an orchestrator that we could use, you know, all the vendors could use, you know, and we made it simple for them, right, because we did all the work. And then they went and said, oh, yeah, you've got to use our orchestrator.
Yeah, they had no real incentive to align with that. They didn't. Because you guys were stuck in
maintaining six orchestrators.
Yeah, and it's awful.
Yeah.
All right, well, we're 40 minutes over. You guys are amazing. This is fantastic discussion. I'm going to appear in the bar later if you want to keep it going.